My dear friends watching us tonight, from the shores of Lake Victoria, we greet you in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I read this morning from the book of Matthew, chapter 11, verse 28, and was surprised at the accuracy of the great invitation to us all who are laboring and are heavy laden. No name attached to it, no address. All we need is to come to this. And this is such a place to learn a little bit more about the Savior to mankind who is giving us the invitation. We should extend a very special welcome this evening to people who've joined us tonight for the first time, the regular attendees, the sick, the maimed, the lame, who have come with a very specific hope of meeting with the greatest physician of all times. Keep on coming. Pass word to all your friends as well. God is good all the time. You know, my friends, I've wondered about something. Do you remember to encourage our friends in the sunset years of life, the old people, to come to these meetings? I see hundreds here. God bless you all. We would like once again to recognize the participation of our friends in the various downlink sites around the world. In Malawi, the churches of Zomba and Luwinga. In Zambia, the churches of Lubuto, Kabwata, Kafue, Cheston, Yuka. And my friends in Kitwe, Pastor George Mwanza sends you his personal greetings. He loves you. In Uganda, Kireka Hill Adventist Church, Ishaka na Janankumbi. Zimbabwe, Kambuzuma, Warren Park. In Rwanda, Gitwe, Butare, Mugonero, Botswana, Mogatisane, Ganzi, and Palapie. In Ghana, Odorkor, Mataheko. I'd like to make a special mention about Angola this evening. In the city of Luanda, we have a congregation that has 6,424 visitors. What do you say out there? In areas that have been affected by war, we have about 2,060 people attending. What do you say? In the country of Lesotho, Mogotlong, Maluti, come on board, Swaziland, South Africa, my friends in Kenya, Bonyonyu, Coast Central Church in Ethiopia, the Filwona Adventist Church in Burundi, in Romania, not to mention India, where we have congregations in Mizo and Pune. We recognize the hardships faced by some of the congregations. I have in mind brothers and sisters in war-torn areas of this world, the refugees, and those with equipment but no sight. Mzizima SDA Church, I have you in mind. We are praying for you and all you ATAP members. Keep up the hard work and the flame wherever you are on this globe. God bless us. It's my privilege this evening to bring to you my sister and fellow servant in the vineyard of the Lord, Mrs. Priscilla Handia Ben. She serves in the East African Division as a director for Adventist Women Ministries and Trust Services. Priscilla would lead us to God's throne room of grace as we stand in prayer. Priscilla.
Thank you. Let us pray. Our kind and loving Father who art in heaven, dear Lord, we are so grateful because your mercies are new every morning. This evening, we just want to glorify your name because we have confidence in you. That, Lord, whatever we ask according to your will, you are going to hear us. And therefore, this evening, Lord, we are asking you to be with Dr. Patzer and the translators in a special way, that the Holy Spirit will give them the thoughts and even the words that they need to make the message clear. And that, Lord, the audience, both here at the stadium and at the downlink sites, we will have conviction and understanding through the Holy Spirit as they hear your word. And that, Lord, they may be receptive to the heavenly word. And that when the appeal is made, we may accept you as our personal Savior and be saved eternally. Thank you for the many blessings that you have given us. And we pray this through the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, with thanksgiving in our hearts. Amen.
Good evening. We're glad that you've joined us again tonight. We are very pleased to be able to finally present you with an email address where you can contact us via email. We also have a fax number that we'd like to ask you to send in your stories of what's happening at your site. There's been some neat things going on, haven't there, Darren?
Yes, there have. Tonight we have a very special feature for you. We have with us representatives from Lightbearers International, an organization that is responsible for thousands of souls entering the faith each year. Tonight we have with us Charles Lawson, Dr. Harry Mahanda, and his wife Esther.
Now, Darren, before you start, I just got to say something neat that our audience would like. Charles is responsible for a lot of that good Mwanza video footage that you saw a couple nights ago. And Dr. Mahanda here was speaking to our local audience last night, so we've got a couple of celebrities with us tonight.
All right, thank you, Natalie. All right, so Charles, tonight we have Lightbearers with us. Tell us a little bit about the background of Lightbearers Ministry.
Well, Lightbearers Ministry began in 1986 in the beautiful state of Washington in the United States. Early on in the ministry, they were invited to come to Africa, and while they were here, they discovered there was a great need for low-cost, inexpensive, Christ-centered literature for people to share the gospel. Well, after that, they went home, bought a copier machine. It wasn't long before this copier machine ran out. It basically died because they printed so much on it. They went on to get a couple printing presses. We're now a fully self-contained publishing house. We print about 40 million tracts a year. That equates to 12 cargo containers of literature. We ship that all over the world to different countries that have the need. And we publish about there's a half a million tracts a day.
Wow, okay,
incredible.
Thank you, Charles.
Well, Charles, you ship so much internationally. Tell us why that's really an important part of Lightbearers Ministry.
Well, we found that where the need seems to be the greatest, the hunger for the gospel is the greatest, there's the greatest need for materials. A lot of countries that we ship to don't have tracts and stuff to share their faith, and we find that it really helps people share the gospel. I might mention that Lightbearers Ministry, in addition to the publishing aspect, they have TV ministry, they do evangelistic meetings internationally. In addition to that, they they have seminars for edification of the church all over North America.
Okay, thank
Incredible.
You.
I'm intrigued by the, you said that you ship internationally. What are some of the places that you've shipped to? And specifically, since we're in Africa, what are some of the neat Africa places that you've shipped to?
Well, today, as I mentioned, we shipped over 240 million publications. We've shipped to countries like Romania, Central and South America, all over Africa, and different parts of Europe.
Wow, okay. And the cost, roughly, that you spend a year on that?
Well, each container that we ship out, the gift that we give to this country, that the Lord gives, is about $50,000 per container.
Awesome, awesome. What a ministry that's bringing
Amen.
Souls into the church.
Amen. We are so fortunate here to have Mr. Harry Mohando and his beautiful wife Esther with us also. And Dr. Mohando is an international evangelist. And Doctor, why don't you just tell us some of the places where you have had a crusade?
I have conducted crusades almost all over the world. Including North America. I've conducted crusades in North America and Europe. I've been conducting crusades in Russia and many countries in Africa and Asia, including Zimbabwe, Nigeria, Zambia, Malawi, Tanzania, Kenya,
wow.
and almost all over the world.
Well, Dr. Mohando, how many from your work would you estimate have been baptized from your international evangelism?
Oh, for the last 5-6 years, we have baptized almost 30,000 precious souls.
Wonderful, awesome. What other programs do you focus on besides the evangelism?
Oh, yes, we have not only been conducting evangelistic crusades all over the world, as I have mentioned, but we have been conducting field schools of evangelism for lay preachers, as well as ministerial students from some of our universities around the world, as well as for pastors. And we educate and train and equip lay members to do more evangelism even after our crusades are done. And they also do follow-up work, as well as conducting more crusades and person-to-person evangelism in different parts of the world.
Natalie, he sounds pretty excited about
yes,
what he
amen.
Does. This is awesome. You can see why people get so excited about the work Pastor Mohando
yes.
is doing.
And he told me earlier that his wife, Esther, is an active volunteer with the Lightbearers Ministry, and we're
awesome.
Thankful for that, Esther. Thank you so much. Now, Doctor, why don't you tell us, where are you going to be next? What's your next project?
Oh, yes. Within the next few months, we shall be conducting big crusades one of the crusades that we are going to conduct will be in the Netherlands, in Amsterdam, but we shall also have another crusade October, November in Andrews University Pioneer Memorial Church. Mm. And then following that, we shall have another crusade in Tanga, Tanzania, and then in Kigali, and then in Kampala in Uganda, and then in Copperbelt in Zambia,
wow.
and many other crusades
awesome.
Here and there around the world.
Okay.
Amen.
Well, amen to that. Thank you so
yes.
much for coming tonight. We appreciate it. The Ministry of Light Bearers, if you will remember to keep them in your prayers, touching thousands of lives each year. Thank you, gentlemen and ladies, for being here tonight.
Thank you.
Thank you.
we need to turn to our theme song. Tonight, we would like to try practice it in English and also in Kiswahili. The Kiswahili script will be flashed on the screens and read it as it is written. We'll do it one time in English, Kiswahili, we go back to English and then Kiswahili. Phil?
I found the way in Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. I found the way in Jesus, He is my way to heaven. I found the way in Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. I found the way in Jesus, He is my way to heaven. No one can stop me now, nothing can stop me now. No one can stop me now, since Jesus is my way.
The Kiswahili now.
Tumeiona njia, njia, njia. Tumeiona njia, njia ya uzima. Tumeiona njia, njia, njia. Tumeiona njia, njia ya uzima. Hata shetani apinge, hata shetani apinge, hata shetani apinge, Yesu atahubiriwa.
One more time in English and then we come back to Kiswahili. All right, we ready?
I found the way in Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. I found the way in Jesus, He is the way to heaven. I found the way in Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. I found the way in Jesus, He is my way to heaven. No one can stop me now, nothing can stop me now. No one can stop me now, since Jesus is my way.
We'll sing it a bit faster in Kiswahili now.
Tumeiona njia, njia, njia. Tumeiona njia, njia ya uzima. Tumeiona njia, njia, njia. Tumeiona njia, njia ya uzima. Hata shetani apinge, hata shetani apinge, hata shetani apinge, Yesu atahubiriwa.
Thank you very much. God bless you.
I'm beginning to think that I'm here in paradise because every evening it's just absolutely beautiful here. And I have to tell you that the program, much of which is actually before our satellite audience comes on, unfortunately, was just fantastic tonight. All of you that participated, the music, the special features, the young people, the children, thank you for what you've done. It's just incredible. I was blessed. In fact, I was actually out with the crowd here watching. I became so enthralled by what was taking place, I almost forgot it was time for me to come up here. But if there had been more music, I guess that would have been all right as well. Well, I trust you've had a good day as well. Wherever you are around the world tonight, this is a special evening for us here. And God is going to bless us. And we've prayed earnestly for that, and I know you have as well. How can I start over? An incredibly important topic that many of you have been waiting for because of decisions you have made prior to or since these meetings began. Tonight, I want to try again to send a special greeting to one of our sites. Well, many of our sites, actually. A lot of our sites in Nigeria. San Nuen Ke U. That means hello, San Nuen Ku. And if I didn't get that close enough, I'm sure the translator did. But we want you to know, thank you, that in Nigeria, all over that country, we're glad you're watching through satellite. Tonight, I want to talk to you about a topic that's very significant to all of us. In fact, some of you are going to demonstrate your belief firsthand, personally, and what I'm going to be talking about tomorrow night in a very public demonstration, and we'll refer to that in a little while. I'm going to give you an opportunity again tonight at the end of the preaching portion of this service to make a standing and a visual commitment to what we're talking about tonight. So be preparing, open your heart to the Lord, and let the Holy Spirit work. It was a number of years ago when I was considerably younger than I am today. I was recently graduated from school. I was a young married man, and it just seemed as though I was always in a hurry. Now, I don't know if any of you are that way or were when you were younger, but it seemed like whenever I got behind the steering wheel of my car, I was in a hurry. And it didn't, unfortunately, always matter what the speed limit was. Now, I live in the United States, as you know. And in certain parts of the United States, particularly in the state of Pennsylvania, where we were living at this time, and we have viewers watching from Pennsylvania, they had a rule, a law, that said if you got a speeding ticket, and they caught you, that you had to pay a significant amount of money, a fine. That was the first time. If you got caught again, you again got fined, had to pay the money. But if you got caught a third time speeding, you also got a fine, had to pay the money. But then you had to go to driver's education school and relearn how to drive only by the laws. Now, no self-respecting, proud man wants to have to go to driving school when he's married and out of school. Well, I got ticket number one. I didn't learn my lesson. I got ticket number two. I didn't learn my lesson. And you guessed it, ticket number three. And in a few days, I got a notice in the mail that said, Mr. Patzer, you are to appear at such and such a police station at such and such a time and go to driver education where you can watch movies like that one about cars that are traveling too fast. Oh man, I didn't want to do that, but there was no way out. And so finally I watched. When the date came and the time came, I drove to that police station, went into a classroom, found a seat, sat down, kind of held my head down, hoping not too many people would recognize me there, and watched as other businessmen and other professionals and other people my age and older filed in and sat down too. It wasn't a real jovial party that evening, I can tell you. And we sat there, and pretty soon the officer came out, walked out into the room, looked at all of us, and thanked us for coming, like we had a choice, and he said, I'm here to tell you that if you don't want to be here, you may leave. I listened. I looked around the room. He said, if you don't want to be here tonight, you can go home. Well, of course I didn't want to be there, neither did anybody else. And I had my eyes fixed on him when he said, you see, all of your fines and all of your tickets and all of your breaking of the law were recorded on a big computer at the Capitol. And the other day, someone pushed the button on the computer and it cleared all the names. I said, yes, I'm out of here. And I was out that door and I went home. Now, friends, there's a lesson for us here about this idea of having our slate cleaned, starting over. And I want to tell you that as important as that was to me and the lesson that it taught me that night, it is much more important what Jesus Christ is willing to do for you and for me. He wants to take our sin-stained records and wash them clean. And he does this through a simple process called baptism. Baptism is a provision God made for us so we can completely start over with a clean record. In fact, Jesus gave his disciples a specific command. It's a familiar verse. It's found over in Matthew 28, the 19th verse. Follow with me. Go therefore and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the world. Amen. Now this command is known in what? Calabar, East Nigeria. Those of you watching there. It's known as the Great Gospel Commission. And baptism was a specific part of Christ's instruction. You see, when men and women heard and understood the story of Jesus that we've been talking about each night and wanted to make a decision for Christ, baptism was the public ceremony marking that decision. It's much like marriage. It's a public ceremony marking the decision of a man and a woman's desire to live together in love. Now, there are several examples of baptism in Scripture. Read with me the one found in Acts 8, verse 12. But when they believed Philip, as he preached the things concerning the kingdom of God and the name of Jesus Christ, both men and women were baptized. Philip was in Samaria, preaching to the people about Jesus Christ. And the Bible says when they understood what Jesus had done for them, they were baptized. Do you know that there are places in the world where people change their names when they are baptized? For those of you watching tonight in Mesoland, India, you know that people in your city choose to take a Christian name because they're starting over. Here's another example of baptism. It's found also in Acts, the second chapter, the 41st verse. Then those who gladly received his word were baptized, and that day about 3,000 souls were added to them. Now Peter preached the word of God, and when the people heard what God could do for them, they were excited and became baptized. Now, did you know there are many different ways people are baptized? Some people are baptized by water poured over their heads. Some are sprinkled. I've heard of people baptized in rose petals, taking roses, crumpling them, putting them over people. But what does the Bible tell us is the correct method to be baptized? I've found that I can trust the Bible. You have too. If it's in the Bible, I believe it. If it's not in the Bible, then it's not for me. We've said that over and over. Notice what John 3:23 says. Now, John also was baptizing in Anan near Salem because there was much water there, and they came and were baptized. You see, according to the Bible, it is very clear that baptism requires much water. Now, if there are any examples that we should want to follow, it would certainly be Christ's example, right? Harcourt, East Nigeria, isn't that right? Matthew 3:16 tells us about the baptism of Jesus. This is what it says. When he had been baptized, Jesus came up immediately from the water, and behold, the heavens were opened to him, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and alighting upon him. Matthew says, when Jesus, our example, was baptized, that he came up out of the water. Mark 1 tells us that Jesus was baptized in the Jordan River. It says this, it came to pass in those days that Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized by John the Baptist. That's how he gets his name, John in the Jordan. Verse 10, and immediately coming up from the water, he saw the heavens parting and the Spirit descending upon him like a dove. Friends, are you beginning to see a picture of baptism from the Bible's perspective? Those of you watching in Kamasi, Ghana, the Scripture tells us that baptism requires much water. Kamasi, you got that? And when describing Jesus' example, it tells us that Jesus was baptized in the Jordan River and that he came up out of the Jordan River following his baptism. And I remember a story that a friend of mine tells me of a man who had a small cart from which he sold various pastries and waffles. He was a friendly sort, and the children loved to hear his accent, so they would hang around and pester him with questions just to hear his dialect, his strange Greek words. And the old Greek man would take a donut or pastry, and he would dip it into a bowl of chocolate and say to the children, "I baptizo it." You see, the Greek word baptizo means to plunge under the water. Not tonight here. Have any of you ladies ever dyed clothing? When the Bible mentions clothing that was dyed, the word that is used is baptizo. The clothing was immersed. And every time Scripture talks about a person being baptized, it means that that person was immersed under the water. When Jesus went down to the Jordan River to be baptized, he too was placed under the water. Now, probably one of the clearest Bible stories about baptism is told in the book of Acts, chapter 8, verse 26 to 28. Follow with me. "Now an angel of the Lord spoke to Philip, saying, 'Arise, go toward the south, along the road which goes down from Jerusalem to Gaza.'" This is desert. "So he arose and went, and behold, a man of Ethiopia." Now this should be interesting to those of you in Addis Ababa, Ethiopia, that are listening tonight. We have a downlink site there. Many of you are there. "A eunuch from your country, of great authority, under Candace, the queen of the Ethiopians, who had charge of all of her treasury and had come to Jerusalem to worship, was returning. And sitting in the chariot, he was reading Isaiah the prophet." Now, I guess it would be nice if we could ride along and read today while we're driving. I know from experience in our modern chariots, that's not a real good idea. But he was doing that. Probably wasn't driving, but the eunuch was reading from the book, the Old Testament book of Isaiah, from the old scrolls, the chapters that foretold the coming of Jesus. As he rode in his chariot, verse 29, it says, "Then the Spirit said to Philip, 'Go near, overtake the chariot.' And so Philip ran to him, heard him reading the prophet Isaiah, and said, 'Do you understand what you're reading?' And he said, 'How can I unless someone guides me?' And he asked Philip to come up and sit with him." And so Philip climbed up into the chariot and explained to him the story of Jesus. Verse 36 goes on, "As they traveled along the road, they came to some water, and the eunuch said, 'Look, here's water. Why shouldn't I be baptized?' And he gave orders to stop the chariot. Then both Philip and the eunuch," the Bible says, "went down into the water, and Philip baptized him." Now, friends, that text does not say that Philip stood on the shore and the eunuch went alone down into the water. Nor does it say that Philip got into the water and the eunuch stayed on the shore. And it doesn't say that Philip put some of the water in a little vial and sprinkled it on the eunuch's head. No, the Bible is very clear. It says that they both went down into the water, and Philip baptized him, put him under the water, and brought him back out of the water. Yes, the Bible is very clear when it instructs us how a baptism should take place. And it's very specific, friends, about the need for Christians to be baptized. But as there are certain things that it teaches should happen before a person is baptized. What do you think there in Kampala, Uganda? A person needs to accept Jesus Christ before he is baptized, because baptism is a public declaration of my acceptance of Jesus Christ. So you see, if I've accepted Jesus as my Savior, which many, many, many of you have done, then I should be baptized. Acts 8:12 goes on. But when they believed Philip, as he preached the things concerning the kingdom of God and the name of Jesus Christ, both men and women, as the picture shows, were baptized. The Bible says that not only do I need to accept, but also I need to believe in Jesus Christ as the Son of God. And then it goes on, verse 8, Acts 18. Then Crispus, the ruler of the synagogue, believed on the Lord with all his household, and many of the Corinthians, hearing, believed and were baptized. So not only do I need to accept and believe in Jesus Christ, but I also need to repent. Now, Peter was preaching on the day of Pentecost to the people who had gathered from all parts of the then known world. The story is written there in the same book, Book of Acts, chapter 2, 36 to 38. This is what it says. Therefore, let all the house of Israel know assuredly that God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Christ. Now when they heard this, they were cut to the heart, the Bible goes on and says, and said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, some of you know this verse, men and brethren, what shall we do, they said. And Peter said to them, repent, and let every one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Now, let me say something about repentance. The Bible says that it is my responsibility to accept Christ into my heart, and that God is the one who gives repentance. Think about that. If you keep your heart soft and open to the work of God's Holy Spirit, God will bring repentance into your life. It's not something that you have to muster up, to work up to. Sometimes people say, well, I'd like to be baptized, but I don't really feel that I've been all that bad. You see, repentance is something that the Holy Spirit gives us. And when you feel the conviction in your heart, friends, then you need to repent. But don't wait to come to God until you feel bad enough. You see, the pre-baptism process continues. The Bible says that people not only need to accept, believe, and repent, but they also need to be taught. That's why you're here. That's why you've come to the downlink sites out there, or this giant stadium. Matthew 28:19-20 again says, go therefore, make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you, and lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the world. Amen. Now, the Bible tells us that people are to be taught. But let me make something very clear. It doesn't need to take years and years and years to be taught the things that you need to know before you're baptized. Why, the eunuch learned the fundamentals during one chariot journey. The jailer's family at Philippi, which we'll look at in a few moments, in one short, memorable stay of Paul and Silas in his jail, learned enough. I once heard a story of a minister friend of mine who was studying with a man in preparation for baptism. For some time, the minister gave the man a large study assignments. He visited him week after week for these teaching sessions, and it had gone on for some months. One day, after studying that second chapter of Acts that we just referred to, the man said to his minister, my friend, you know, Pastor, I think if Peter had put all of those people at Pentecost through what you've been putting me through over these weeks, there wouldn't have been anywhere near 3,000 people added to the church that day. He had a point. Sure, there are basic Bible teachings that you need to understand, But friends there in the Sunnyside Church in Pretoria, baptism is not just a graduation ceremony. It is not a reward for your perfection, nor is it a mark of completion. It is a mark of a new beginning. Let me say that again. It is a mark of a new beginning. You see, baptism is when God wipes your slate clean, like I had it back in Pennsylvania with my bad driving record, and you move forward with Him without all those infractions and the accompanying guilt of your past record that could weigh you down so heavily. Now, Paul and Silas had been arrested, beaten, chained, put into prison for preaching and healing and spreading the gospel of Jesus. At midnight that night, Paul and Silas began singing. Can you imagine that? You're in prison, they began singing. And suddenly, there was an earthquake that knocked the doors down and broke the windows open. And the chains around their wrists and their ankles dropped to the floor. And the jailer, who was responsible that none of the prisoners escaped, saw what the earthquake had done, and fearful of his own execution, actually, the Bible says, knelt down to take his own life. Because by law, if he lost one prisoner, he would be executed. His life for the prisoners. But Paul intervened, and he said, "Do yourself no harm. We're all here." And the jailer got up, and he went, the Bible says, and he fell prostrate before Silas, begging, "What must I do to be saved?" Acts 16:31-33 goes on, and it says, "So they said, 'Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and you will be saved, you and your household.' And the jailer took them to his home," verse 32, "and then they spoke the word of the Lord to him and to all who were in his house." They taught him, in other words. And now what happens in verse 33? "And he took them the same hour of the night, and he washed off their stripes, and immediately he and all his family were," what? "Baptized." So you see, preparation for baptism is not necessarily a long process. Look at what happened when Peter, there in Acts 10:44-48, was visiting the household of Cornelius, a Roman soldier. This is what it says. "While Peter was still speaking these words, the Holy Spirit fell upon all those who heard the word. And those of the circumcision," that means the Jews, "who believed were astonished, as many as came with Peter, because the gift of the Holy Spirit had been poured out on the Gentiles also. For they heard them speak with tongues and magnify God." And then Peter answered, "Can anyone forbid water that these should not be baptized who have received the Holy Spirit just as we have?" And he commanded them to be baptized in the name of the Lord, and then he asked him to stay a few days. Now these people accepted Jesus. They gave their hearts to him, and they were baptized. The Bible makes it perfectly clear, friends, that as you and I make the decision to accept Jesus into our life, that we must follow his example and be baptized. And many opportunities, how many of those do we have to really start over with a clean slate like God offers us? You see, baptism offers us a chance of a brand new beginning. No old baggage, sin hanging over our heads, just that golden-tipped hope for a new life with Jesus Christ. The act of baptism represents something very specific. We find it in Romans 6, just after Acts. Chapter 6, verse 3 and 5. "Or do you not know that as many of us as were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death?" So we find that baptism represents the death of Jesus. But it also represents something else. Verse 4 continues, "Therefore we were buried with him through baptism into death, that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life." So not only does baptism represent the death of Christ, but also his burial and finally his resurrection. Verse 5 goes on, "For if we have been united with him in the likeness of his death, certainly we also shall be in the likeness of his resurrection." You see, friends, it also represents that I am willing to crucify the old man of sin. It means that all of my sins have been buried, and that is exactly what I mean. Someone has said, "Don't bury the spear with the handle sticking up so that it can be used in the future." No, God says he will take all of our sins, cast them into the depths of the sea, and remember them no more. The Bible says that he justifies us. That means that he treats us as though we had never, ever sinned. Incredible. Praise the Lord. It represents the resurrection to a new life with him. Isn't it wonderful what God will do for us? Did you know that there are a dozen or more different ways to be baptized? Let me name just a few of the ways for you that I've heard about. Some baptize with a pinch of salt, a few drops of oil, laying on of hands, baptism of the desires of the Holy Spirit, baptism by mail, baptism by phone, effusion, sprinkling, triune immersion. I even once heard of a movie star who was baptized, as I mentioned earlier, with rose petals. And the list goes on and on. So when did all of this change? When did we get away from the Bible example of baptizing in water? Let me tell you what happened. If you and I were to leave here or wherever you are tonight and fly away to Italy, right beside that Leaning Tower of Pisa is a building that is a baptistry that has been there for centuries. And it has a beautiful fount for baptism by immersion. In fact, there are lots of old churches in Italy that have baptistries. They aren't for sprinkling or pouring. They are for immersion. In fact, there's kind of a funny thing that happened to one of my friends. He went there. He's a minister. He went there, and he wanted to go into the church and take a picture to show how they used to baptize there biblically, and they wouldn't let him in with his camera. So my friend went downtown and bought a collar, a reverse collar that some clergymen wear. He put it on, and he came back to the same church and with his camera said, "I'd like to walk into your church." And they said, "Oh, fine, Father, come in, take your picture." And so he got the picture. Didn't want him in there before. You see, they're not particularly proud of the fact that the manner of baptism has changed in many churches today. The only way people were baptized, however, before 1100 A.D. was with immersion. And then a new belief entered the theological society, the churches, the scholars, called the doctrine of limbo. Now, my translators tell me that some of you don't have that word, and it doesn't translate well. But basically, what it is, it's an intermediary step where small children would go, they thought, and live until they matured to decide whether they would go to heaven or to hell. And so this limbo, in the English word, is a belief that if a baby died before he was baptized, it would go to limbo until it grew up a bit and then go one direction or the other. Now, since some of the people had this belief, They decided then it was necessary to baptize babies and children before they died. Why? Because there's a text in John 3, verse 5, that says this. I tell you the truth, no one can enter the kingdom of God unless he is born of water and the Spirit. You see, these folks were afraid that if their babies died before they were baptized, they would be lost. And so they began to sprinkle them. And that's the way the baby was baptized. That is how the form of baptism changed from the biblical mandate and example to what is practiced by many today. It was not until the Council of Ravenna in 1311 AD, after Christ, that sprinkling and pouring were officially accepted as equally acceptable as immersion for the rite of baptism. By many churches, obviously, not all churches. Well, now that brings up a question. We've just read a text that told us that unless one is born of water or is baptized, he cannot enter into heaven. So how are we going to look at that tonight? Let's explore that question as we read in the book of Matthew, chapter 3, verse 15. This is what it says. But Jesus answered and said to him, "Permit it to be so now, for thus it is fitting for us to fulfill all righteousness." Then he allowed him. What's that mean? Jesus came to John the Baptist and asked that he, personally, Jesus, could be baptized by John. But John looked at Jesus, knew he had never sinned, knew he didn't need to be baptized, and he refused, saying he wasn't worthy to untie even Jesus' sandals, let alone baptize him. But Jesus said, "Permit it to be so, to fulfill all righteousness." Now, why did Jesus need to be baptized? Had he sinned? Cameroon? Those watching from there? No. Because he was our example. Wasn't the example of the disciples good enough, you might say? Evidently not. But further, like the thief on the cross, there may be examples of those who couldn't be baptized. Or maybe someone who gives their heart to God on a battlefield, and then he dies before he has the opportunity to be baptized. Or yes, again, as we talked about a few moments ago, a baby that dies before they grow up. For them, Jesus' example will be sufficient. So then, who needs to be baptized? Well, first of all, when you accept Jesus Christ, as we said before, as your personal Savior, and many, many of you have done that, you need to be baptized. Let's look at it again. Acts chapter 18, verse 8. Then Crispus, the ruler of the synagogue, believed on the Lord with all his household, and many of the Corinthians, hearing, believed and were baptized. Secondly, Ephesians 4:5 says, "One Lord, one faith, and one baptism." Now, friends, when the scripture says one baptism, it's talking about the way a person is baptized, not the number of times a person is baptized. Get that clear. Therefore, if you were baptized in a way other than the way the Bible teaches, if you were sprinkled or poured, or if you simply had hands placed on you, and you were not baptized by immersion in water, then you need to follow Jesus in his example. That's why Jesus was baptized. Let me clarify something. People may say, "Well, Dr. Patzer, my mother took me when I was just a baby and had me baptized." Well, good for your mother if that's the case. She was doing what she felt was right in her heart. Bless her heart. And God honored that at the time. But that does not release you, my friend, from your responsibility. You see, when you come to a knowledge of what God's Word says, then you need to step out in faith. And thirdly, Ephesians, further back in the New Testament, 5, verse 25 and 26 tells us, "Husbands, love your wives just as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for her, that he might sanctify and cleanse her with the washing of the water by the word." You see, the Bible compares baptism to a marriage. One of you, two of you that have been attending these meetings, was married in this town earlier this week. You can relate to that, can't you, Peter? You were married this week, and Esther. If you accepted Jesus Christ, then you left the Lord. I'm not talking about stumbling or making a mistake. I mean choosing not to serve God, and you are coming back. You need to be baptized again. Let me give you an example. If I and my wife, for some reason, were to get divorced, heaven forbid, and we went our separate ways for years, we lived apart, and then somehow we decided that we had made a mistake and wanted to get back together again, we would need to get remarried. Now, if we had just separated for a few days, should we remarry? No, of course not. And the same thing is true with baptism. Acts 19, 1 to 5 tells the story of Paul at Ephesus. And it happened while Apollos was at Corinth that Paul, having passed through the upper regions, came to Ephesus. And finding some disciples, he said to them, "Did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed?" And so they said to him, "We have not so much as heard whether there is a Holy Spirit." And he said to them, "Into what then were you baptized?" And so they said, "Into John's baptism." Here, Paul met some disciples who had been baptized by John, but they didn't understand all about Jesus Christ. And when Paul taught them about Jesus, notice what happened next in verse 4 and 5. And then Paul said, "John indeed baptized with a baptism of repentance, saying to the people that they should believe on him who would come after him, that is, on Christ Jesus. When they heard this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus." Now, there may be some of you who were baptized as a little child, and you didn't really understand what was happening at all. But when you finally understand what the Word of God is saying, you need to be baptized again. There may be some of you out here or at our downlink sites whose Christian experience has grown to such an extent that you feel that you need to be rebaptized. You see, Saul was a very religious man. Saul was converted on the road to Damascus. You know the story? The light shone down on him brightly. He was knocked to the ground. He was blinded, and he was led to the city of Damascus, where the Lord told a man named Ananias to pray for Saul that he might receive his sight. Ananias obeyed. God returned his sight to Paul. And then Ananias said these words to Paul. Now it is Paul, because his name has been changed. God said to Paul through the prophet in verse 16, Acts 22, "And now, why are you waiting? Arise and be baptized. Wash away your sins, calling on the name of the Lord." Why are you waiting? You see, friends, if you've accepted Jesus Christ, if you need to be baptized, why are you waiting? Why are you waiting? Wash away your sins. You can start over. You can have the record completely washed clean. No matter how awful those sins may be in your past, they can be washed as white as snow. Paul said to the Philippians in chapter 3, the 13th and the 14th verse, "Brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth to those things which are ahead, I press toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus." forget those things that are behind. The Bible says, forget those things that are behind and accept Christ's invitation to follow him and be baptized. Friends, I want to encourage you to make that decision. Hundreds of you have made that decision already. Thousands of you made it the other evening. And many, many, many came forward right here in this stadium. You can start over with a clean record tonight. This picture, these video clips were from the other night right here in this stadium, where thousands of you came forward, significantly representing those in some of the downlake sites as well. You cannot even begin to see all the people that came forward. Tonight, I want to ask you again to join those people that came forward Wednesday night. I want to ask you if you want to stand with me tonight and say, Jesus, I love you. I want to thank you for all you've done. I told you we'd have another call tonight. I want to ask you if you want to tell Jesus tonight that you love him, whether it's for the very first time here in the stadium or out in one of these downlink sites. If you want to accept Jesus into your life for the first time or just again, I invite you to stand to your feet right now. Stand with me and say tonight, Jesus, I just want to tell you that I love you for your example, for dying for me, for being baptized for me as an example, for your word. Jesus, I love you for so many reasons. And as you stand there quietly at your seat, think of the reasons why you thank Jesus tonight for what he's done and accept him back into your life as your Savior. But then I want to go to two more groups tonight. Those of you that were in that video clip a few moments ago, those hundreds and hundreds and 2,000 or 3,000 people, they tell me, that came forward even right here in this stadium to be baptized. You've made a decision. Many of you have been studying for weeks, and many thousands, I am told, will be baptized tomorrow. Tomorrow, thousands of you will be baptized. If you're in this stadium tonight and you came forward the other night, we want you very quickly to come back tonight. Come forward tonight. Would you begin right now coming down to the platform, right down to the front? Those of you that have made that decision already before tonight, maybe you made it a week ago, maybe you made it longer. There are those that will greet you down here, but we would like to have those of you that are planning on baptism in the very near future and have made that decision either the other night or even before these meetings began to come forward very quickly. We'll wait for you, but come down right here. We want to do something special. We have something special. Come down quickly if you're planning to be baptized while my friend Walter Ortiz sings.
Just as I am without one plea.
This is a huge stadium, and it takes a while, but come, we will wait.
Thy blood was shed.
You've made a decision to be baptized before tonight. Maybe you're going to be baptized tomorrow. Many of you are going to be baptized tomorrow, and you're looking forward to tomorrow. Those of you that are standing, pray for these individuals. This is such a significant decision. They're coming now, coming. Bless your heart. Some from the choir. Yes, your song was beautiful tonight. Those that are already planning on baptism, many of you tomorrow. Bless your hearts. This is so thrilling. Those of you that are planning on baptism, you've already done the studies, you've been attending the meetings, you've made that commitment. Come on down to the front. Hundreds and hundreds are coming.
Of God I come.
keep coming. Bless your hearts. We're not going to have a long call tonight, so come quickly. Bless your hearts. Yes, you're still coming, still coming. I wish those of you at the downlink sites could see this. But right now, for a moment, I want to talk to you at the downlink sites, because some of you out there have made decisions to be baptized as well. Some of you are going to be baptized tomorrow or in the very near future. If you have already made that decision to be baptized and you're watching in one of the hundreds and hundreds of downlink sites, I want to speak to you right now. Stand to your feet, because God will see you at that site just as well as he's seeing these hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of people here that are planning on being baptized tomorrow. If you're at a downlink site and have made that decision to be baptized, stand to your feet and come forward, because a leader will be waiting for you. A pastor or a lay leader is waiting for you to have prayer with you. Yes, bless your heart. Still coming, still coming. Hundreds more are still coming. Proud of you. Keep coming, yes. Young man, proud of you. Still coming, still coming. Bless your hearts. These are people that have made a decision, that have studied, that have been attending the meetings, that are planning to be baptized. Already, if there's any more that are planning, come forward right now. Those at the downlink sites, be praying for these people here and at your own site. And then in a moment, when all of this group that's planning already on baptism, and this is so fantastic, heaven is happy. Heaven is happy, I see. All right, if you all, many, many more coming. Bless your hearts. Bless your hearts. Coming. Mothers, fathers, come with your children. Bless your hearts. Bless your hearts. Yes, God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. All right. Now, I want to make a specific call. Okay, just a minute now. Just a minute. Just a minute. I'll shake your hand. Just a minute. I want to make one more final call. One more final call. There are those in this audience tonight. There are those in this audience tonight that have not yet made a decision to be baptized, either here in this stadium or in our audience at these downlink sites. I want to speak to you for a moment. You have seen these thousands of people come forward. All of these hundreds and hundreds of people, God is calling you to make that decision as well. I want to encourage you tonight. You have not made the decision to be baptized before tonight. And I want to invite you to do that right now. Jesus has spoken to your heart. Maybe you've been baptized before through one of these other 12 ways. Rose petals, sprinkling. Something else. But tonight you saw that God wants you to be baptized by immersion. I'm not talking about tomorrow. There's still more study that you'll want to do. You'll want to attend the rest of these meetings probably. But you want to give your life totally, completely to God. I want to encourage you tonight to join those that are already standing here at this stage, or those who are standing at our downlink sites, to come forward right now. Come forward and accept Jesus as your Savior and his manner, his example of baptism. Won't you do that tonight for him? That small church, that large outdoor congregation that's meeting out under the trees, wherever you are right now, if you have not been baptized the Bible way, I invite you to come forward. Those of you in this stadium, if there are those that have still not come, bless your hearts. Yes, come forward. Come forward now and make that decision for eternity to follow God and his example for baptism. We'll wait just another moment. Pastor Ortiz will sing while we wait for any more that want to come forward that have not made that decision. Those of you in those downlink sites, let me talk to you once more. Tonight's the night. God brought you to this meeting to see this on the screen for a special reason, because he wants you to say yes, to be baptized, to publicly demonstrate your commitment to him. Don't be afraid. We talked about the other night. Sometimes it does cost us everything. Sometimes even your family may reject you, at least for a time. But for what Christ has done for you, it is worth it. It's worth it. Won't you come forward right now? Say yes to Jesus. Yes, after more study, I want to be baptized the biblical way. We've explained it. It's clear. The Bible has told us how. And now it's your responsibility to respond. Listen quietly. And then we'll have a prayer of dedication. And to those of you here, many of you here are going to be baptized tomorrow. You have made heaven so happy. We look forward to being there with you and watching as you're baptized in Lake Victoria. What an awesome experience that's going to be. And then many of you will be baptized in various cities around Africa and even beyond. We'll look forward to hearing those reports. And the email address will be on the screen here and at our downlink sites so that you can give us reports of how God has worked in your area. Just a moment, as the last ones come forward here and anyone else at a downlink site comes, and then we'll have our closing prayer. Come forward. You're being patient. Bless your hearts. Song says, I come. I come. And you have come. Praise God for these decisions. Won't you just bow your head right now with me and let's ask God to bless the decisions that have been made tonight. Dear Father in heaven, our Father in heaven, as we have bowed our heads this very moment, hundreds and thousands have come forward here and at our downlink sites. We know that heaven rejoices. I pray that you will bless every individual that has made a decision either before tonight or tonight to be baptized the biblical way through immersion. Lord, bless each one. And whatever the sacrifice, may they see that it is worth it in light of eternity. Bless them each one. Give them a safe passage home tonight, back tomorrow. And for those who will be baptized tomorrow, may your presence go with them especially. Keep them safe tonight, and may nothing deter them from following through tomorrow and being baptized into your giant kingdom of eternity. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen. Thank you for coming tonight. Tomorrow's topic, as you see on the screen, a topic that you need to listen to. How can I find truth in a confused world? There is so much confusion out there. You know that. I know that. Millions of people think the Bible says we should go to church on Sunday. Millions think we should attend church on Saturday. Millions think we should go on Friday. We're going to see what the Bible says tomorrow night. Be right here, and we'll look forward to you. God bless. God bless. We'll see you tomorrow.